this is going to look back into the past. Jesus said that as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be. Talking about the time of his visitation, his picking us up and taking us home to be with him, that it will be like it was in the days of Noah. We don't have a lot of records on that. Genesis is vague. Most of what took place before the flood were things that God didn't consider worth noting. We know that there were some things that took place before then, because Genesis says there was. One thing that I got interested in here recently, I'm a sci-fi buff from way back, and I recently read an article on Yahoo that said that there was a scientific breakthrough concerning the Neanderthal man, that they had just about succeeded, or had succeeded. I'm not exactly sure where they're at with it, but they seem to think they're pretty close anyway, to isolating the DNA sequence, the genome for the Neanderthal man. I went before the Lord. I mean, to me, that was perfectly, so sensible, and asked him about Neanderthal man. An idea came to mind. I had the interesting idea that was the mark of Cain. I had always understood it was something put on the forehead of Cain. Scripture doesn't say that. The scripture in Genesis chapter 4, verse 15 says that this was an answer to Cain's protest upon the judgment that God had put on him. The Lord said to him, "Therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold." And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him. I can't find anything that would really discard the notion. Let's put it this way. I can't substantiate that the mark of Cain turned him into a Neanderthal, but God is very capable of putting a mark at the level of the DNA spiral. He's very capable of it as the creator. Part of being a creator is being creative. This is why I'm convinced to this day, this is why Satan counterfeits so much of what God does, is because he lacks that creative spark that God Almighty has. But the thing of it is, and, the listener may be saying, well, he's pretty creative coming up with this. Like I said, I have not been able, I may never substantiate it, but I can't unsubstantiate it either. I can't just discard it. There are several things that kind of point in the direction that maybe that might be right. Neanderthal man, according to the research, and I've read several articles on this, Neanderthal man was a primarily carnivorous creature with a pronounced ridge along his eyebrow area that had protruding bone that would, cause the flesh to come out. Not to slur anybody's reputation, but if anybody ever followed along with pro wrestling, been around for a while. If you've ever seen the face of Andre the Giant, you've seen a pretty good example of what a Neanderthal facially and you know, head-wise, would have looked like. He had a lot of resemblance to that. And I've heard Andre's was a neat fella, and I always rooted for him. But the thing of it is, you know, he did have a very unique look to him. But the Neanderthals were, according to the articles that I read, were very fast, were stronger than average humans. And in my mind, it seems to me like it's extremely plausible that God might have made this kind of a change with Cain. If you look a little bit back behind the scripture I just read, this is the full statement that God placed on him after he answered God, you know, am I my brother's keeper? This is Genesis 4, verse 10 and forward. He says, and he said, talking about God, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. Now recall that the whole dispute between Cain and Abel came because God did not regard Cain's offering. Cain's offering was from the fruit of the ground. Cain was a farmer. And God is telling him, now you're cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond you will be on the earth. God had placed a curse on Adam that he would eat from the sweat of his brow, that the earth would resist him. Cain is being told, the earth won't resist you. The earth simply won't cooperate with you at all. You are not going to farm. To tell a farmer that would be devastating. And Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Surely you have driven me out this day from the face of the ground. I shall be hidden from your face. I shall be a fugitive and a vagabond on the earth, and it will happen that anyone who finds me will kill me. And the Lord said to him, therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him. My answer to anybody that says this can't be is, what was Cain supposed to eat? As a farmer, he was washed up. There was no chance that he was going to farm successfully after that. So what you end up dealing with is he's going to have to find another food supply. Up until that point, people seemed that they were pretty much vegetarians. Adam and Eve were even beyond that in the garden. It says that they were able to eat of the fruits. So apparently fruit alone provided all the sustenance they need. When they fell, it says the curse that Adam had to deal with. Cursed is the ground. This is Genesis 3, the latter part of verse 17. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. So they were no longer at that point just able to subside on fruit. Now they needed carbohydrates, they needed grain and bread, which is made from grain. So now their dietary needs were met through the carbohydrates, and now Keynes went beyond that, and he's going to have to make do with what's available, which means in order to eat, he's going to have to kill. He killed his brother, and now every time that he wants to eat again, there's probably going to be another killing taking place. It made a hunter out of him. And the idea that he might have had his mark, that God made the mark at the level of the DNA and, you know, genetic manipulation, that God altered him, actually might be kind of merciful, for the simple fact that a stronger, physically stronger, faster man would have better success at chasing down fleeing prey. So I can see that as being something that would be beneficial to him, you know, in a back-ended way. Apparently, Cain was also, according to, well, the Neanderthal man, has a 30% bigger brain case due to the reshaping, you know, the different shape of his head, which would make Cain to be a very intelligent fella, probably even more so than he was to begin with. And I think that's kind of interesting in the fact of where his kids ended up. It says it follows the line right underneath the scriptures I just read to you. It follows the line down, and it says that Cain built a city. So, so from farmer to murderous contractor. Oh, boy. He named the city that he built after his son, Enoch. This was before Enoch the seventh from Adam that was born through Seth. But anyway, he went down through the line here, through the rest of Genesis chapter 4. And it says that the musicians came from Cain's line. The craftsmen came from Cain's line. And there was a fellow down here called Lamech, which is where they show the end of the line for Cain's offspring. I'm assuming that him and his family were the ones that, you know, got washed away in the flood. Lamech said to his wives, Adon, Zillah, hear my voice. This is chapter 4, verse 23. Wives of Lamech, listen to my speech, for I have killed a man for wounding me, even a young man for hurting me. If Cain be avenged sevenfold, then Lamech 77-fold. Notice he didn't announce it to God. He announced it to his wives. Apparently this vengefulness was something built into the family.